might be it's recording starting. You now.
It's started now. You just started it. Do you want to start?
Yeah.
Okay.
What's finish mean?
Looks like you've got the whole...
I don't think you have to move it. Now, if it would die on you, time out. I don't think it will, but my code is 1501.
Okay.
And then look for the Facebook post.
Yep. You already got people on, so we're good.
Good deal. Good deal. Thank you for watching now.
No problem.
If you need to, you do have some ability to move a little bit.
Okay.
Pretty much make her happen. Make it happen.
Nope. You can stand up.
There is power, power, working power. Please,
we're going to go.
There is power in the blood of the Lamb. You believe that?
Amen.
Yes. And we all can testify to it. Many of us can testify to it greatly about the power of Jesus Christ. How it's transformed our lives, made us new, changed us, healed us, and brought us to Him. We gather together today to celebrate Christ Jesus. He's our reason for being here. He should be our focal point. With everything we do today, let's celebrate Jesus with our conversations, with our hearing of the word, when we commune later and around the table, and when we lift our voices in these songs of praise, let Jesus be preeminent. We're going to go to Him in prayer right now, and just after that, we'll continue to worship the Lord. Father, we give You thanks for the day that is this day. This is the day You have made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it, as the scripture says. It's a day, Father, we can arise from our beds and know that our sins are forgiven in Jesus the Christ, Your Lamb. Father, thank You for Your willingness and wanting to save us, for making a way that would be so terrible even that it would cost Jesus His life. It's so wonderful that You express Your love to us through such an amazing act. And we gather together today, Father, to celebrate that. We ask Your blessing upon all that's done, and even more than that, we pray that we might be a blessing to You today as we come together to worship You. Thank You for each one that's here. Thank You for all those who are listening online right now as I speak, or later on today. Lord, we pray a blessing on the household, and it might be a week that we serve and give You glory. Let it start right now, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Continue. I know You rescued my soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe. My shame is taken away. My pain is even pain. I believe. I believe. I'll raise a banner. My Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. I know You rescued my soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe. My shame is taken away. My pain is given in vain. I believe. Oh, I believe. I'll raise a banner. My Lord has conquered the grave. My Redeemer. My Redeemer lives. 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 You lift my burden. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives. My Redeemer lives.
fear less. I was a youth minister for 10 years before I began to be a preacher, and this was a song that my mom taught, I learned, and I passed on. It's a children's song that has some emotions to it. Some of you may have learned it years ago. 12 men went to spy on Canaan. 10 were bad and 2 were good. What did they see when they saw in Canaan? 10 were bad and 2 were good. Some saw giants big and tall. Some saw grapes in clusters fall. Some say God was over all. 10 were bad and 2 were good. Now, I thought about having us do the motions and sing it and try it together, but you get the idea. That story summarized this account we're going to look at in Numbers 13 and 14. But it's also found in Deuteronomy chapter 1. The story begins with Moses and the people of Israel. They've gone from Egypt to the Red Sea. They've received the Ten Commandments at Mount Sinai. They're really on the edge of the new territory. I put a picture of here, what they might possibly have seen just over the boundary of going into the Promised Land. And on this stage of a new opportunity, God authorized 12 men, one from every tribe, to go scope out this land and see the risks and the rewards of an inhabiting that new territory. And so God sends a committee of 12 men to do this mission. Now the key question, how does the committee of 12 work out? And if you've read the story or been taught years ago, you know it well, but it doesn't end up very good. You see, 10 were bad, and 2 were what? Good. Years ago, I heard this statement, "For God so loved the world that he did not send a committee." When you get a bunch of people together, sometimes in a group, we can really foul things up. Aren't you glad God sent his one and only Son to die for our sins and achieve that mission on our behalf? Aren't you glad one did that for us? But I still think the point of the sermon I want to share with you, more than anything, God wants all his family, whether it be the Old Testament people or we of the New Testament who follow Christ, we are to fear less and be full of faith, because we've got a mission he wants us to do. And so first, I want you to see that 12 men take a 40-day test. They were to go spy, scope out the land for 40 days, and when we come back, we hear their report. Verses 21 to 25 reveals that 10 of those spies give a negative report, and they are full of fear. In fact, they do admit to Moses and all of those of Israel that that land over there in Canaan was full of milk and honey. They could see it was bountiful, a place you wanted to live. But all they could see were the problems, and they focused on three things: the grapes, the giants, and the grasshoppers. Now, think about the first. The large grapes that they presented. In fact, the grapes were so big in Canaan, they cut a cluster and they had 2 people carry them on a pole in between them. You would think that the grapes would not be a problem. Just think of how much wine these Jewish people could make with those grapes. But they were not encouraged. They were challenged. The 10 spies noted that the people were strong. The cities were surrounded by great walls. There were many people living there. And then they said, "We even saw giants." There were big people there. They were NBA size kind of guys. And they're more powerful than we. And then finally, the 10 said, we are like grasshoppers among them. Now, isn't it typical that a group of people given a mission to do, if we're not careful, we'll just see the problems and not the potential. And the problems often slow us down. Wayne Smith once said, you'll never go downtown if you wait for all the lights to be green. Sometimes there's going to be little things that will stop us, that will challenge us. And the 10 spies saw some problems that made them fear. They were not ready to move forward in secure the land. I have three reasons why I think they feared. First of all, they were a little hesitant to take a risk. It's been said you can't discover new oceans unless you have the courage to lose sight of the shore. How far are you willing to go and trust God? These 10 spies stood on the boundary of what God called the promised land before them. God said he was going to give them a place where they could build their homes, cultivate their crops, raise their families, and enjoy a relationship with him. But when they just spent 40 days there, though they saw it was a beautiful place to be, they didn't think it was worth the risk to move forward. They were hesitant to take the risk. And then two, I think they feared failure. The fear of failure will kill an individual's performance, let alone when we put us all together. How many athletes never take the field because they're afraid they might get cut trying out for the team? Those of you who are young and venture that opportunity, remember Michael Jordan. He got cut from the eighth grade basketball team. But that first failure never made him fearful to try again. In fact, as he progressed in age and matured and trusted his talent, and I want to believe he trusted God, he became one of the greatest of all. How many companies have never been started? How many inventions never got patented? How many souls have never been won because we haven't gone beyond our boundaries to reach out with the good news to someone because we fear they might reject us? We would fall flat on our face trying to share the story of Jesus. You see, fear breeds fear. Fear can paralyze you. And then fear gets magnified. Man, that's a giant challenge right there. I read Ellen Guder in the book, God on Board. She wrote, you can live on bland food so as to avoid an ulcer. Or you can drink no tea or coffee or other stimulants in the name of health. You can go to bed early and stay away from nightlife. You can avoid all controversial subjects so as to never give offense. You can mind your own business and avoid involvement in other people's problems. And you can spend money only on necessities and save your whole life. But you can still break your neck in the bathtub and that will serve you right. Is it possible we never take a risk, we never branch out, we never try something new because there's a fear of failure? Maybe God is speaking to you today to say, quit playing it safe and trust me. If you read to the end of the story, it's sad. God closed some promising doors for many of the Israelites because they wouldn't venture forward when God said go. And my challenge to you, the church today, is don't miss out on some of God's best blessings of your life because you're just afraid to try. And then third, the spies compared themselves with others. They saw some people who were large in number and even taller than them. giants, the Bible says, and we're like grasshoppers. Theodore Roosevelt said, comparison is the thief of joy. It'll stop you in your tracks. And these 10 spies compared themselves to grasshoppers compared to the people they needed to battle. But I had a preacher who wrote this. He said, what's wrong with grasshoppers? Don't you know grasshoppers can fly? Most grasshoppers are pretty strong flyers, and they make good use of their wings to escape predators. And the Bible says, when tempted, God will give you strength to withstand or a way to get out. Grasshoppers come in three colors. Brown, green, sandy. Brown to live on the ground, green to live in plants, and sandy to live on the beach. God will give you the ability to adapt to your environment. Grasshoppers have ears on their abdomens. Their auditory organs are on their abdomen, their belly. Now, how convenient would that be if we were a grasshopper? Because faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And don't we Christians almost always, all we do is eat. And grasshoppers team up. A lone grasshopper does little harm by himself, although they eat about half its body weight in plants per day. But when they team up and they swarm, their combined feeding habits can turn a farmer's crop into a deserted field. The point is, if we live as a pack of grasshoppers, there's no idea what we can do together. Sometimes we just got to think God's thoughts, not our thoughts. And far too often we find others more powerful, more productive, more taller, talented, intelligent, witty. But we never remember what God has placed in us individually and then what we can become together. There may be others who are blessed by God, but you don't know what obstacles and fears they have overcome to prevail and enjoy the life they live. David became a better person because he faced Goliath. The Hebrew children were thrown into the fire. They became better and were the toast of the town. Samson needed the Philistines in order that he might shine. And the children of Israel needed that obstacle, that challenge, that problem before it that they called giants to make them a better people. To live and trust God. And so we all need struggles to allow us to bring the best out of us who will believe and who will fear less. God wants us to take risks, never fear failure, and to quit comparing ourselves with the world. Because God is with us. You see, 10 were bad because they were full of fear. But thank God there were 2 that were good because they were full of faith. They feared less than the other 10. And so I want you to look at the minority report. Look at verse 30 in Numbers. We have Caleb. You often hear the name Caleb in the Old Testament. Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, we should go and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. And then the other spy, which you've probably always heard, the name Joshua. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into that land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. Only do not rebel against the Lord, and do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone. But the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. How many of you know the names of the 10 spies? I don't. They're listed, but you never hear anybody name their children after the 10 spies who gave the bad report. But how many times do you hear in the world today the name Caleb or the name Joshua, because people know those stories in the Bible and they think they're people of optimism and they want their children to have that in their life, their makeup? In all honesty, some of you know my firstborn was a boy who died at birth, stillborn. We named him Caleb because my goal for him was to be an optimistic person, a person who could take the Lord and go wherever the future might hold. But in God's providence, it was to directly to take him into his presence. I love the name Caleb. I love the name Joshua because of what they stood for. They were men of faith. You see, 10 saw obstacles, 2 saw opportunities. 10 were focused on problems, 2 were only seeing the possibilities. 10 feared when they looked at the giants, 2 had faith when they remembered God was with them and what he had done in the past. You see, Caleb even mentioned, don't forget what we did when we left Egypt, when we crossed the Red Sea, we've seen his power on Mount Sinai. He is ready to lead us into the promised land. And so I want you to see these 2 spies who did good. They desired to immediately obey God. Numbers 13:30, Caleb said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are able to overcome. Sometimes if we delay, it only leads to denial and disappointment. 2nd, they focus on seeking to please God. Why wouldn't we want to make God smile by what we do with our life on his behalf? Look at Numbers 14:8. If the Lord delights in us, he will bring us into the land to give it to us. If God be for us, who can be against us? Paul said. You see, we need men and women of faith who see the invisible, hear the inaudible, believe the incredible, think the unthinkable, and then try the impossible unless God is with them. In Hebrews 11:6 says, without faith, it's impossible to please God, because everyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him and who seek to please him. And then 3rd, Caleb and Joshua trusted God's presence that he would protect and deliver them victory. Just like Clayton Kershaw, though he's a great pitcher through the season, had trouble winning games in the playoff and the World Series, he finally broke through. And he stayed the course. He wasn't afraid of failure. He kept pitching that ball. He never gave up. And with God's help, he, in the last couple weeks, has won 1 World Series game. Can you trust God's presence like Joshua did? Verse 9, only do not rebel against the Lord. Do not fear the people of the land, for they are our bread. We're going to eat them alive. Their protection has departed from them, and the Lord is with us, so do not fear them. Man, if you have a coach who's rallying the team, you've got to have someone who believes you can win the game. And you've got to have somebody who will try their best to do that. Believing with God, anything is possible. I want you to see this statement. Just this week, I was working on this sermon, and it's amazing to me how quotations come your way. This was on Facebook. Some of you know Tyler Perry. Here's what he says. It doesn't matter if 1 million tell you what you can't do, or 10 million who tell you no. If you get one yes from God, that is all you need. Are you listening for God to say he's with you? Are you listening for God to say, I can help you with me and you? We can make a difference. And who among us haven't laughed at Tyler Perry's movies and Medea?
Yes.
And brought joy in. And at the same time, he enriched his life. You see, when God is with you, you can do all things. And so I want to ask what the task is before you right now. What's your tendency? Are you going to say, I can't do that because I don't have the time, I don't have the money, I don't have the ability, or whatever other kind of excuse we could list? Or are you going to stop yourself with the what ifs? What if I fail? What if I run into a problem? What if this thing goes wrong? I don't. What if? That will stop you in the track. We've got to have some people, men and women of God, boys and girls, growing in faith, who say God is God, or I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. And so we need to build our lives based on his promises and not our capabilities alone. And if we remain fearless and full of faith, we will be rewarded like Joshua and Caleb. I want you to see the verdict from God. God was a little frustrated with the ten. Here's what he said in verse 26 of chapter 14. Not one of them will ever see the land I promised on oath to their ancestors. No one who has treated me with contempt will ever see the promised land. But because my servant Caleb has a different spirit and follows me wholeheartedly, I'll bring him into the land, and his descendants will inherit it. Verse 38, and of the men who went to explore the land, only Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, survived and entered the land. Do you understand what the book of Numbers is? The book of Numbers is two numberings of the population of Israel. The population of Israel when they come out of Egypt. And then the population of Israel when they go into the promised land. And the population of those who go into the promised land, only two men and their descendants, Joshua and Caleb, didn't go into the promised land because of their optimism, their faith, their reliance on God. And I believe that's the verdict for you and I who fear less and are full of faith as we are on our journey living in these challenging times. Would you stand with me right now? I'm almost ready to hear. I want to ask a question. What is the greatest risk you've ever taken? I don't know if this was the greatest, but I remember this risk I took. My family moved from Hartford, Kentucky to Williamsport, Indiana when I was in fifth grade. And after that fifth grade year, that summer, the city park had a $6 season pass. I delivered newspapers, I saved up $6, and I went to the swimming pool at the city park almost every day that summer. But at the start of that summer of that sixth grade year, I saw all the older kids jumping off the low dive. I'd never done that before. I did that. And then I saw some of those teenagers go up on that 12-foot high board. And I thought, man, if only I could do that. And so one day I climbed up those steps. It seemed like it went forever. And then you have to hang on really tight to get up and on that board. And then you walk out on that board and you stand and 12 feet down is a long way down. And I can remember just right on the edge thinking, I should go back. I should go back. But there was a young lady lifeguard. Well, one of the households I delivered newspapers to, she said, Kevin, go ahead and jump. I will save you if you need any help. And I thought, boy, I'd like her to save me. And so I wanted to dive. I kind of bent over, and then I thought, no, I'm going to go belly buster. I have nothing to do with it. So I just jumped. Feet first. And you know what I did? I hit the wall. And I went deep. But I came back up. And she didn't have to save me. I went to the side. And you know what I did? I climbed up that ladder one more time. That was such a thrill to do something I'd never done before. I'm going to do that again. I got to the end of it. This time I jumped out about 4 feet. Each time I jumped, it was fun. And I survived. And I knew I had a lifeguard if I ever needed it. I just want to ask you about your faith. What's the greatest risk you've ever taken with your faith? You know, I'm a preacher, and I've tried for 42 years, whether it's a youth minister or a preacher, to challenge people who hear the story of Jesus and all the great people of the Old Testament and New Testament who follow Jesus. Would you, with your life, risk following him? Would you walk out to the end of the board and stand there and jump and take a leap of faith? Would you, maybe, if you've heard about Jesus in your life, and you believe he died and was buried and rose again, that he came back to life after 3 days of death, and that he said, go make disciples, I'm going to the Father, but I'm coming again. And if you believe that story is true, that he says, I'll save you if you'll hear this, believe in me, repent of your sin, if you'll confess Christ, if you'll be baptized, would you just leap into my arms? I'm here to save you. He's already passed the test. He's ready to dive in with you. He is present, but it's up to you to individually take that leap. I know there's others who are taking that journey of faith, and now they're so glad they have. They're trying to figure out, okay, what's the next thing I ought to do for God? And I hope it's one day say a public prayer. I hope it's one day teach a Sunday school class. I hope it's one day I'll be an elder in the church. One day I'll preach a sermon, and maybe I would even dedicate my life to preaching the good news. One day I'll be bold enough to get out of my hometown and be a missionary. But it takes somebody who hears that is a mission. God would say, I'll bless you, I'll be with you, but you got to take a jump. I'm just wondering if there's someone here today who would give a good report on God. Take a risk. Don't fear failure. Quit comparing yourself with others. You're not as good as God. You need to be forgiven by God. Would you do your best to just leap and say into his arms, I'm going to trust my future. And you know what? With his help, he will rise you up. You may not walk on water, but you'll be good in his name. And God will bless you all the days of your life. And he gives you a gift of heaven, which is a reward that I believe is out of this world. If you want Jesus today, if you would follow him, would you come right now as we sing? Ken, lead us in our song of invitation. If you would make a decision for Christ to accept him, make a confession, be baptized, use this church as a church family where we walk together and we become like grasshoppers who devour everything else around us for God's good. Would you join us here at River Valley?
Lord, calling your name today.
It's after the fall of Adam and Eve, and God is
said some things to Adam, and he said some things to Eve, and he says some things to the serpent, the evil one. He gives a prophecy there that's the first prophecy of Christ. Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. He says to the serpent, talking about the offspring of Eve, generations later, that he says, serpent, you will bruise his heel, but he will crush your head. It doesn't take a whole lot of biblical savvy to get what's going on there. You'll put him on a cross, but he'll turn that cross around and crush your head with it. See? And Paul alludes to that, I believe, in Romans 16:19. He says, be excellent at what is good. He's given us all this advice. Be excellent at what is good. Be innocent and equal. For the God of peace will soon crush Satan or crush him underneath your feet. In the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Victory over the evil one. So let us endeavor today as we meet around the Lord's table. To take those words of Paul to heart, to be excellent of what is good and to be innocent of evil. Let that be our goal, our bar for the week to come. Be excellent of what is good, church. Be innocent of evil, my friends. The God of peace is soon crushed at you. Let's thank Jesus for what he did for us. Let's ask a blessing upon the loaf and cup today as we meet around the table. And thank God. Where it started in Genesis, started before that, but the first reference, Genesis 3:15, that God is our champion through Jesus Christ. Father, we have some enemies, and we have succumbed to those enemies. All have sinned and fallen short of your glory. We have the enemy of sin and death and grave and hell. And Lord, we are powerless. Stand against these enemies on our own. We have no wherewithal whatsoever to fight against these spiritual forces that are not in our favor because of sin. But we thank you, you've made a way to the cross, that you crushed the evil one. That when we resist him, he flees from us, and when we turn to you, you draw near to us. Lord, thank you for the Christ who died, who washed away our sin. And make it as though we had never sinned, justified in your presence. Lord, thank you for the cross. We ask your blessing upon the loaf and the cup today as we partake. May we treasure what Jesus did this morning as we celebrate this Lord's Supper. And Lord, may we examine our lives to cling to that which is excellent and good, that we might please you, as Kevin mentioned a moment ago, our desire would be to make you smile. Thank you, Father, for blessing us. May we be children that bless our Father. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Voice and work in the world today.
There's a card ministry out in the foyer. If you want to pick up a card and sign that card and send it to some of those on our prayer list, please do that. We're just so grateful. Next Lord's Day is our 16th year anniversary. We invite you to come. We'll celebrate together 16 years, completing 16 years of serving the Lord. And who would have thought 16 years ago that we'd still be faithful serving the Lord? I hope we're faithful for another 16, even though some of us might be like that group in the first numbering and not in that second numbering of numbers. But we want to be faithful and enter the promised land in the presence of the Lord forever. And if you agree with that, then say amen.
Amen.
Why don't you stand and close with prayer? Kim, would you give our closing benediction?
Lord, you are a good, good Father. May we leave here today, no matter what this world's throwing at us, no matter how gloomy it might be out there, no matter how down some people may be around us, Lord, may we have a smile on our face because of what's in our heart, that we know you are a good, good Father. May we be your children and give praise to our good, good Father this week. Thank you, Lord, for all that's happened here today. We ask for your blessing. May we bless you. We pray it in Jesus the Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
God, come today.